Today we're taking a look at the new Latte Panda IOTA, which packs Intel's new N150 processor into something barely bigger than a Raspberry Pi, and it's got a few surprises under the hood too. We'll take a look at the hardware and accessories available for it, then boot it up, test video playback, run some benchmarks on it, and then measure its power consumption and thermal performance. So let's get started by getting it unboxed. This is the Latte Panda IOTA Single Board Computer or SBC, and it's available in a few different kit options with different add-ons. I've got some of those here too, which we'll also take a look at a bit later on. The IOTA measures 88x70x19mm, which is really small for its features. It maintains the same size and basic port layout as the older Latte Panda V1, so it'll be compatible with most of the older enclosures, and it's intended to be a drop-in replacement or upgrade. It might look like this is the CPU, but that's actually on the back of the board. This is a 4-core Intel N150 CPU that can run at up to 3.6 GHz. That's paired with LPDDR5 RAM running at 4800 megatransfers per second, and it comes in an 8GB and 16GB variant. It's also got onboard eMMC storage. The variant with 8GB of RAM has 64GB of storage, and the 16GB version has 128GB of storage. This is the 8GB of RAM and 64GB of storage version. Then we've got the onboard RP2040 microcontroller, which is what sets this board apart from most other x86 mini PCs. This is a dual-core Cortex coprocessor that handles the I/O through the GPIO pins, similar to a Raspberry Pi. There isn't much else on the bottom. We've got a power management connector here for other power input options, and then a fan connector on this side. On the other side, we've got all of the ports and interfaces. Starting on the left side, we've got three USB 3.2 ports, then an HDMI 2.1 port, which will do 4K 60Hz, an I2C port for a touch display, an EDP display connector, a PCI Express 3.0x1 port, implemented in a similar way to the Raspberry Pi 5, a battery connector and power input connector, then along this side is a USB Type-C power delivery input, a microSD card slot, a headphone jack, and a single gigabit Ethernet port. Then across the last side are the power and reset buttons, a GPIO header, and finally the MCU reset and boot buttons. On the top, we've also got a M.2 eKey port for a Wi-Fi adapter. The IOTA has a configurable TDP in the range of 6 watts to 15 watts, which allows you to balance performance and power or heat. At a lower TDP, it can run completely silently with a large passive heatsink, or you can crank this up to improve performance and use an active cooler, which is what I've got for it. In terms of pricing, I think it's priced quite well. This is the base model with 8GB of RAM and 64GB of storage, and it's priced at $129. This goes up to $175 for the 16GB version with 128GB of storage. At the very least, you'll need to add a $12 cooler to either option, so all up, I think it's still a good deal for under $150. To add to the IOTA functionality, they have a couple of optional add-ons, and I've got some of those here. This is the Smart UPS Hat, which is a plug-and-play uninterruptible power supply that can keep the IOTA running for up to 8 hours, depending on the batteries you use with it. The smart features include auto power on and a safe shutdown when the battery voltage gets too low. It interfaces with the board through the power management connector we saw earlier. Then there's a 51W PoE++ expansion hat, which allows you to power the IOTA from its onboard gigabit network port. This hat plugs into the board's power input connector at the top, as well as into the PCIe port. So you then have two network ports as well. Then we've got two M.2 expansion boards, one with an M-key slot to add a 2230 or 2280 size NVMe SSD, and another to add a 4G LTE module for remote connectivity. The NVMe adapter plugs into the IOTA's PCIe port, and the LTE adapter connects through a USB 2 interface through the GPIO pins. Now let's get it booted up to run some tests. First up, let's try video playback at 1080p and then at 4K. For each of these tests, I've set the system display resolution to 1080p and 4K respectively too. Video playback at 1080p in a window is perfect and didn't drop any frames. Opening it up to full screen drops a few frames while expanding, but then runs perfectly too. Switching to 4K, in the window it drops quite a few frames, and this is the same in full screen. Watching the frame drop counter does make playback seem worse than it appears. Playback's still fairly smooth and doesn't stutter. I'd say the stream is still usable, although it's definitely close to the limit for this board. Next, let's try run a few benchmarks. I first ran the Unigen Heaven benchmark to get a sense of how the integrated graphics perform. With default settings at 1080p and quality set to high, it scored 221 points, with a minimum of about 5 FPS and a maximum of about 20. So this definitely isn't going to be good for gaming. It's capable of rendering 3D scenes, but it's more in the light workloads category. As expected, this is about on par with results from an N100 CPU. Next, I ran Geekbench 6 to test CPU performance. It scored 910 in single core and 2002 in multi-core, so it's fast enough for day-to-day tasks like web browsing, media playback, and light productivity, though you'll start to feel it struggle with heavier multitasking or any kind of video editing or gaming. To check storage performance, I ran Crystal Disk Mark using 3 1-gig tests. The onboard storage reached 288 megabytes per second reads and 206 writes in the sequential test. Random 4K speeds came in around 40 for reads and 46 for writes, which means everyday performance like booting, launching apps, or opening files should feel reasonably fast, but it's not anywhere near as quick as an NVMe drive. In terms of power consumption, at idle on the desktop, the IOTA draws around 3 to 5 watts, and with a full CPU and GPU load, this goes up to 15 watts, with spikes of up to 19 watts. I also tried adjusting the TDP settings. Turning this down to the minimum 4-watt limit, we get a total power draw of around 5 watts. So quite a significant reduction in power consumption, but also in performance. This limit makes Windows 11 very laggy, so you'd probably need to use a lightweight OS at this limit, but it's still impressive that you can get an x86 PC running Windows 11 down to this power draw. Thermals are quite good with the active cooler. At idle, temperatures remain around 45 to 50 degrees, and this goes up to around 70 degrees under a sustained full CPU and GPU load. The problem with the active cooler is the fan noise. It runs at around 34 to 35 decibels at 20 centimeters away while at idle, but this goes up to 50 decibels under full load. This is quite loud if you're going to be using this board on your desk or near your workstation. The sound level itself doesn't do it justice. It's particularly annoying because it's quite a high-pitched sound too. So overall, the Latte Panda IOTA is a really capable little board. It's compact, power efficient, and packed with I/O. I think the addition of the RP2040 microcontroller is what makes this a really attractive option over other mini PCs, as it opens up the door to projects that blend PC-level performance with real-time hardware control, like robotics or automation builds. It's not the best choice if you're just after an everyday mini PC. There are cheaper N150 boxes out there for that. But if you want something you can actually build projects with, or integrate into your own hardware, then this is a really solid option. Let me know what you think of the Latte Panda IOTA in the comments section below, and what you can see yourself using it for. Thanks for watching. Please remember to like this video if you enjoyed it, and subscribe for more tech and electronics projects, tutorials, and reviews.